Hi everyone, my name is Annika. Today I'm going to be walking us through a sample CARS passage. Normally I like to recommend spending about 10-ish minutes on each one of these, but today it'll be a little bit longer since I'm going to be talking through it. Today we're going to be practicing two strategies which I think are really useful for CARS. The first is reading actively. And so what we're going to do is take a pause to read every single paragraph and then reconvene to summarize the main idea. And this will just really help us make sure we're keeping track of the main points of the passage as well as an orientation of where we are in the passage. The second thing we're going to practice, which is a really big part of CARS, is finding textual evidence to support all of our answers. So for CARS, all the information you need will be right in the passage. So we're going to really practice using the passage's direct words and phrases and quotes to make sure we arrive at the correct answer. So let's get started. The way that this is going to work is I'm going to have all of us pause the video as we read each paragraph and then unpause it when you're ready to go over the main idea. So to begin, let's just pause and go ahead and read the first paragraph. Okay, so hopefully we've read the first paragraph. One thing that is interesting to note is that unlike a lot of CARS passages we're probably used to seeing, this is written in the first person perspective. It's almost like a diary or a journal or something. So the first paragraph is really about how there's this plague that's come back to Europe. It looks like the government is trying to keep it a secret for some reason. Okay, go ahead and pause and read the second paragraph. Okay, so as we read the second paragraph, again, we're talking about the plague. We know that in the first paragraph, a couple people have died. And in the second paragraph, doctors have gone to the house and confirmed that it was the plague publicly. Okay, go ahead and pause and read the third paragraph. Okay, so the third paragraph is kind of an extension of the first couple paragraphs that we talked about. It looks like, understandably, as more people are dying from the plague, people are getting even more worried, as they should. Okay, go ahead and pause and read the next paragraph. Okay, so now we're talking about what people are doing about the plague, and it looks like there are some rich people that live in the rich part of the city, and they're able to leave, and there seems to be some kind of exodus of people trying to get away from the plague. Okay, go ahead and pause and read the next paragraph. Okay, so this paragraph is really talking about the author grappling with his decision. It looks like he's deciding whether or not he should leave, depending on what's best for him. There's also a couple sentences in the latter part of the paragraph where he's talking about, you know, how it would affect the townspeople, you know, what he cares about the townspeople, that sort of thing. Okay, go ahead and pause and read the last paragraph. Okay, so the last paragraph is kind of an extension of the previous paragraph. The author is still again weighing the pros and cons of leaving, and here we learn a little bit more about him and sort of the cost that it would require for him to leave. So these are kind of the things that he's weighing in his decision to get out of the town for the plague. Okay, so now that we've done this, we've made sort of a mini outline for ourselves on the left of the passage, which is really helpful because now we sort of know all the main points that the author is trying to make throughout, and we also know, hopefully, where to find information if we get a question that's asking us to look for a specific thing. So this is a really important part of reading actively, and I definitely recommend that when you take CARS passages on your own, you do this either in your head or on paper. Okay, so now let's get into the questions. Number one, based on paragraph 3, which of the following most nearly means distemper? Okay, so here we have an exact cue to go look in a particular place, paragraph 3, and we're looking for the word distemper. So let's go to paragraph 3 and figure out where the word distemper comes out. Okay, so it looks like we see it here. Another man died in the same house and of the same distemper. Okay, so in my head, I know that temper means like something that causes someone to get angry, but it looks like that may not be the right context that's used in this passage. So it looks like here it's something you can die from. So let's look at the answer choices. Can you die from a disposition? Maybe, but probably not. Can you die from a cause? Yes, you can die from a cause. However, if we look at answer choice C, that's shouting out at me because it's a little more specific and it's more relevant to this passage. They died from the same distemper they died from the plague, which is a disease. Finally, can you die from resentment? Perhaps, but that doesn't really seem to be what this passage is about. So for this, it's really important to make sure that if you know the definitions of particular words or if you know particular ideas from like outside of cars, try not to let those kind of hinder you from looking directly at what's in the text right in front of you in a particular passage. Okay, number two. From the passage, one can reasonably infer that what? The city lacked a middle class. Okay. I don't know if the city lacked a middle class. We do know that they had a rich class because the author did talk about the rich leaving like in a mass exodus. I don't know if we have enough information to assume A. B, the author did not have the means to leave town. It looks like the author actually did have the means to leave town. If we look at the last two paragraphs, we see the author grappling with his decision. He's deciding whether or not he should leave town. And if he wasn't able to, he probably wouldn't have to make this decision. He just wouldn't be able to. So I'm going to go ahead and eliminate B. C, the plague was new to Europe. Okay, so it does seem like it's sort of new because people are kind of getting scared about it. It looks like it's kind of just starting. But let's just double check. So if we look at this paragraph, in the first paragraph, it says, oh, I heard an ordinary discourse that the plague was returned again in Holland. Okay, so that tells us that maybe the plague has come back and it's new for people now, but it had already been in Europe at some point. So let's go ahead and eliminate C. The government sought to prevent mass hysteria. Okay, I don't remember the words mass hysteria, but I do know that mass hysteria is like when people get scared in large amounts of people get scared. I do remember the first paragraph we talking about how the councils held about ways to prevent its coming over and all was kept very private. This does seem like government trying to prevent mass hysteria by keeping everything about the plague secret. I think this is a reasonable assumption to make. And I'm going to go ahead and eliminate A again because we don't have any reason to believe there's no middle class. There could potentially be one. Okay, number three. Which of the following statements, if true, most challenges the author's assumption? Okay, those who fled the city were more likely to die from the plague. This already seems like a red flag to me. If you're more likely to die from the plague, why would the author consider leaving? Why would the rich leave? That doesn't really make a lot of sense. So I'm going to star this one because I think this is it. But let's just check. The plague did not kill everyone who got it. The author only had information about a couple people who died from the plague. It does seem fairly lethal if everyone is being pretty scared of it. I don't know if this really challenges his assumption. Even if it didn't kill everyone who got it, it would still, you know, potentially just cause a lot of harm to anyone who did get it. So I don't think this challenges any assumptions. The plague was not brought from Italy. Does the author claim that the plague was brought from Italy? It doesn't seem so. It says some said it was from Italy, others from the Levant, others from Turkey, others from Cyprus. So it looks like the author is kind of exploring all these places it could have been brought from, but the author is not fully saying it was brought from Italy. So this would invalidate what some of those people think, but not what the author thinks necessarily. International commerce was negatively affected by the plague. Okay, so does the author claim that international commerce was not negatively affected by the plague? I don't even remember really too much about international commerce, so this answer choice kind of seems a little bit out of scope. But just knowing about how people are leaving and how people are dying, it probably would actually affect international commerce just by, you know, my reasoning. So I'm going to go ahead and eliminate this. So I'm going to stick with answer choice A. This makes the most sense. If you're likely to die from the plague if you leave, then you would definitely not want to be leaving. Okay, question four. The passage offers no information about the author's what? Marital status, upbringing, occupation, or motivations. Okay, so right off the bat, I know they talk about the author's motivations. The entire last paragraph is talking about, or the last two paragraphs was talking about the author deciding whether or not he should stay or whether or not he should leave, and he or she was definitely going into how they didn't want to die from the plague. They also had a business to think about. There was definitely a lot of information about their motivations. Occupation. We did see in the last paragraph that The author carries on a business in a shop, which was considerable. I think that's enough information about their occupation. So we do have some information about that. Marital status. I don't remember that being a focal point of the passage, but I do remember a particular phrase, which was the author saying that I was a single man. Okay, so single man, but he has a family of servants. So if it's a single man, probably not married, that's probably enough information about marital status. So I'm going to go ahead and pick B. I don't remember reading anything about his upbringing. Okay, number 5. What does the passage suggest about the nobility of the city? Okay, before we look at the answer choices, I'm just going to sort of predict what they might look like. I do remember when they were talking about the nobility or like the rich people, they were definitely fleeing the city when the plague got rough. So maybe it has something to do with that. They did not care about their servants. Maybe, maybe not. I don't remember that particularly being an explicit point made. So if we did assume this, it might be a little bit of a stretch. They had the resources to leave town. Okay, that sounds exactly like my prediction. They had the resources to leave town, and they did. They were well connected with the local government. Could potentially be, but maybe not, because like nobody really knew what was going on. The local government was trying to conceal the plague from everyone, so I don't think it's C. They were more fearful about the plague than others. I don't necessarily know if this is true. I'm sure that they probably had more means to do something about their fears of the plague just because they were rich, but I don't know if like a lower class individual of the city would be any less fearful about the plague than they would be. So I'm going to go ahead and stick with answer choice B. Okay, lastly, this passage would most likely be found in a blank. Okay, so as we talked about when we first started reading this passage was interesting because it was written in the first person perspective, which not a lot of Carr's passages honestly are. So let's take a look at these choices, and it was definitely like a personal account of the author's experience when the plague started, as well as his thinking about, you know, what to do about it. So let's look at these choices. A history book. So this could be like a textbook. I don't necessarily think that textbooks are filled with this kind of text. They're usually more factual and third person, and you know, they try to be as objective as possible. So I'm going to go ahead and eliminate A. Scholarly journal. So we could think about this as like a peer-reviewed journal where you have like scientific articles or historical articles. Again, I don't necessarily think this would be in an article like that. Those are usually trying to describe things or analyze things. They usually have experiments in them if they're scientific. I'm going to go ahead and eliminate B. Autobiography sounds compelling. Autobiographies are first-person accounts of things. You know, people write them for themselves. This does sound like if the author were to write an autobiography, this could be a chapter in that book about, you know, how he experienced the plague. So I'm going to go ahead and stick with this one for now. And then lastly, newspaper article. Those are not necessarily as like factual or objective or third person as the history book or scholarly journal, but I do feel like you wouldn't really have too much first person like diary journal entry style in a newspaper article. So I'm going to go ahead and stick with C. Great. So I hope that this was helpful to anyone watching. In your own practice, I definitely recommend these strategies of reading as actively as you can and using as much textual evidence you can to support any answer choice you pick for your Carr's passages. But yeah, if you have any questions about how I walked through this passage or how I approach these questions, please feel free to email me. Otherwise, good luck and happy studying.